name is Vedant. I'm an Android developer at Byju's. People who don't know what Byju's is, we are the largest digital education platform in the world. And people who watch TV already know us.
My name is Jitin. I work as an Android engineer at Gojek. We develop super application called Gojek in Indonesia. And we do everything from ride-hailing, food delivery, and whatever you can think of. And we have an office in Bangalore, so I'm from Bangalore. Today we are going to talk about Kotlin multi-platform. So how many of you have used Kotlin? Raise of hands. Okay. How many of you have used Kotlin not on Android? All right. So today we are going to focus how you can use Kotlin on platforms other than Android and how you can do code sharing around that part. But before we dive into how platforms have worked, we are going to see how platforms themselves have evolved over the time.
We all know computer can understand only ones and zeros, right? So in initial days of computing, people did not have the luxury of writing code like today we do. They did not have any modern sophisticated languages. And that's why the only option for them was to use binary code. Binary was great, but the only problem with binary is it's not very human friendly. You cannot understand what's written there, right? And that's why assembly was invented. With assembly, we made our code a little bit human readable, but now the problem is you cannot execute this program on a machine. And that's why someone had to write a thing called assembler. You can think of assembler as another program which takes your assembly code and convert it to binary code. And once you get the binary code, you can execute it on a machine. Everything was working fine, but we started inventing different kind of computers, like computers with different architecture, computers with different architecture set, and that became a problem. Program written for a particular type of computers were no longer valid for a different kind of computers. There was a solution, and the solution was to write the same program multiple times, then follow the whole procedure all over again. You have to give your source code to assembler, and assembler will give you machine readable instructions. And then you have to take those instructions and give it to their appropriate machines. As you can see, this solution worked, but it's not a very great solution, right? Writing the same program multiple times is not a very good use of your time. And that's why we moved to C++. With C++, we took a slightly different approach. We made our program more human readable. And instead of an assembler, we started using something called compiler. You can think of compiler as an assembler only. It just takes your code. It just takes your source code and convert it to binary code. But please keep in mind that assemblers and compilers are not exactly the same. They have some basic differences. Remember the problem with assembly code where we had to write the same program again and again for different kind of PCs? With C++ or C, we don't have to do that anymore. We can just write the program once and use different compilers to compile our program into binary code. This is a good solution, but not the best one, right? So we had to do something different.
So a few years later, we came with the concept of Java programming language and Java virtual machine. So what Java did, Java provided a better syntax at writing programming. You didn't have to care about a lot of stuff around garbage collection, and you know, you had a better library structure, better frameworks. With Java, what we did is, we created something called an intermediate bytecode. So you write things in Java, you send them to Java compiler, and then you get a bytecode. This bytecode is then executed by Java virtual machine. So this bytecode is meant only for the virtual machines. It's not human readable. And as long as you have virtual machines installed on your certain platforms, be it Mac OS or Windows OS, you could run these things everywhere. So you write Java once and then run everything through Java virtual machines. This worked very well until you have platforms like iOS where you cannot install Java virtual machines and Java programs don't work there. We have another platform called web. So web mostly works around with JavaScript, and it's the internet. And there we write JavaScript. Now JavaScript doesn't have any compilation feature inside it, it doesn't compile, it's directly interpreted. So with JavaScript what we did is we wrote JavaScript and then it's directly interpreted and platforms then execute those instructions. On top of that we built platforms like V8 compiler or SpiderMonkey on which Chrome and Firefox run. Now with what V8 does is V8 compiles JavaScript into native code and executes at platform level. So similar to JVM, but there is no compilation or intermediate bytecode involved. So V8 also forms the base of technologies like Node.js. So this is another platform which we work mostly around. Now coming to Kotlin multi-platform. So Kotlin theoretically says that with multi-platform, you can run Kotlin code anywhere. You can run it on Android, you can run it on iOS, you can run it on web, anywhere where it can compile to. So how does it do that? So if you look at broader look at all these platforms, if I have a Android or a Java application running on a computer, I need Java bytecode. On web, I need JavaScript. On iOS, I need something based on Objective-C because iOS base is Objective-C. And then I want to run on other platforms, let's say embedded platforms or Raspberry Pi. I need a native binary which can directly execute on those platforms. So that's how Kotlin does that. So let's see how Kotlin can create all these things.
Okay, let's see how we can take Kotlin and convert it to something like bytecode, JavaScript, Objective-C or native binary. All you have to do is take your Kotlin code and compile it using different compilers. For the output to be in bytecode, we will use something called Kotlin C. And this is the compiler we all Android developers are familiar with. For JavaScript, we will use Kotlin C.js, and for Objective-C and native binary, we will use LLVM. Everything in this slide is straightforward except for this LLVM part. So let's see what LLVM is. LLVM was initially known as low-level virtual machine, but now it's just a standalone acronym. In LLVM toolchain, there are three parts, a backend, a frontend, and something called LLVM intermediate representation. And when I'm saying terms like frontend or backend, don't think of it like HTML CSS frontend or Java Python backend. You can imagine frontend as compiler 1, backend as compiler 2, and you can think of LLVM intermediate representation as something like Java bytecode. The job of the frontend is to take any high-level language like Kotlin, Swift, or Haskell and convert it to LLVM intermediate representation. And this intermediate representation is not architecture specific. It's extremely generic. And the job of the backend is to take this intermediate representation and convert it to architecture specific binary code. Good thing with LLVM is that you can write your own language using LLVM. All you have to do is just write a frontend for it. Your frontend will take your language syntax and convert it to LLVM intermediate representation. And once you do that, you don't have to worry about compiling your code to 10 different architecture systems. Backend will take care of the rest. And Kotlin team did exactly that. They made a frontend compiler for their Kotlin native language, which takes Kotlin native and convert it to LLVM intermediate representation. So technically, yeah, and the compiler is known as Conan. I think you have heard of it. So in theory, you can run Kotlin native in any platform that is supported by LLVM, like Mac, Windows, Linux servers, even in the web. And I think that's the reason why people get confused between Kotlin native and multi-platform. Just to be clear, in Kotlin multi-platform, we just share the common code, not the entire code base. It's not like compiling all code for all platforms. It's more of like compiling the common code for all platforms and write the architecture-specific or platform-specific code in platform-specific languages. We use Kotlin native in our multi-platform also to write Kotlin platform-dependent Kotlin code for native platforms. Now as you know what LLVM is, let's get back to where we left.
So now we have set a precedence that how Kotlin can run, can compile to other platforms. So if we focus on mobile platforms, we got mobile, Android, web and iOS, right? And Android is mostly Java based, iOS is mostly Objective-C based and web is JS based. So if you want to talk about Android, we can take our set of common Kotlin code, a set of platform code for which we need platform APIs from Android, which are written in Java. And through that, we can build a jar. That jar can be then directly imported by any Android project. Similarly, with JS, Kotlin JS is a transpiler. So Kotlin JS does not involve any compilation. You write a common Kotlin code, but with interop, what you can do is you can import JavaScript APIs directly into Kotlin files. So like DOM APIs or any W3C APIs, you can directly import them in Kotlin files. You can manipulate DOM in your Kotlin files, and then it just converts your Kotlin code into JavaScript code. There is no compilation involved. The end output is JavaScript. And then once you have a JS, you can directly write in our browser. With iOS, we come to Kotlin native infrastructure again. So with iOS, we have Objective-C. So similar interop is available with iOS also. So you can import iOS APIs directly into a Kotlin file, combine them with your common Kotlin code, and create something called a framework. This is a iOS framework. Now this can be imported by any iOS project because it's a iOS framework. It's not something related to Kotlin. So we have a mobile set of platforms and a way to create frameworks and jar files for them.
Okay, let's take a simple example of an app. This is a news app. You can browse through all top headlines, and if you like something, you can bookmark it for offline viewing. If you want to build this app, the main tasks will be creating the user interface, creating some data models to hold our app state, calling the network to get latest deadlines, parsing the network response to some useful classes, adding business logic like we might want to filter some news based on some keywords, and storing it into DB. If you carefully observe that create models, parsing response, and business logic is platform agnostic, right? No matter in which platform you write this app for, but implementation of creating models, parsing response, and business logic will be always the same. Creating UI is something totally platform dependent, and we do not want to share that. Calling API and storing DB has some platform dependency, but using some multi-platform libraries, we can achieve that too. If we want to make this application for Android and iOS, let's see how we'll structure our code. Since create model, parsing response, adding business logic has nothing to do with platform, we just simply put this inside our common Kotlin code. We'll put calling API and storing DB inside our platform dependent Kotlin, and we'll talk about it later. And we will write our UI in totally platform-specific languages. For Android, we will use XML and Java. And for iOS, we will use Swift.
Let's talk about something, a very trivial thing, a network call. So any modern application will need a network call, right? And most of the time, we are using HTTP for it. Now, HTTP itself as a protocol is not something which depends on platform. You can do HTTP call anywhere. Irrespective of that, every time we go to a platform, we have a separate library for it. For iOS, we have separate libraries for HTTP, for Android, similar, right? But why? If you look at HTTP methods like get post, they don't change over platforms. Your properties of HTTP like URL, content path, or headers, they always remain the same. And in most of the cases, you will be hitting the same endpoint when you're developing an Android or iOS app. The things where these things branch out is serialization and threading, because their platform-related things come into picture, like how will you run your network call on a background set. It differs between Android and iOS. So let's take an example. We're going to use a library called Ktor. It's developed by JetBrains, and it's a networking library around Android. You could build servers out of it, as well as use it for client-based networking around multiple platforms. So with Ktor, we create something called a HTTP client. Yeah, it's visible. And we install features around it. So what is a feature? Every time I do a network call, let's assume that we are getting a JSON. In our code base, we really want to manipulate JSON. We want to manipulate objects. Now, objects require serialization, because JSON probably you'll get as a string, and then you need an object. So we are going to use a library called Kotlin Serialization Library. It's a library, again, developed by JetBrains for Kotlin. it allows us to transform the JSON into data objects, and it works across multiple platforms. So the same piece of code can transform JSON into an object across Android and iOS. So in our HTTP client, we are going to install this feature. So the basis is that whenever you do a network call, you directly get back an object instead of a string. Now, when you do a network call, let's take an example of a simple get call. Get call again requires a URL, host, and encoded path. Now, again, coming back to the initial slide, that these things do not change across platform. These are platform agnostic, so there is no point of repeating them over Android, iOS, or web. So we are going to use client.get, and then we are going to reuse this thing across Android and iOS. But doing a network call is a different thing when it actually performs on Android and iOS. For example, Android does not allow network call on main thread. In iOS also, you want to move the network call to something asynchronous. So here we are going to use something called dispatcher. So we are going to run this network call through coroutines, which is a Kotlin's internal asynchronous library. What this network dispatcher is? First of all, we create something called an expect variable. Now, expect and actual are Kotlin multi-platform's way of providing abstractions across platform. Think of them as interfaces where concrete implementations are present inside the platforms. So your common code can declare an expect variable that this is expected, and then your platform can declare an actual variable. So your common code does not tell what dispatcher is, but Android tells, okay, this is a dispatcher.default, which is from coroutines Android library, and it just redirects to a thread pool of executors. So with this, we create a dispatcher that this network call is gonna route through a thread pool of executor on Android. But we are gonna need the same thing on iOS also. So on iOS, we create our own dispatcher. So the base thing is we pass this network call through something called dispatch underscore async. Now what is dispatch underscore async? If you look at the import statement, we are doing something called import platform.darwin and dispatch underscore async. Now this is the interop which I was talking about. So when you have used with Kotlin with Android, this interop is like directly available. Every time you import a jar file, you can directly write code in Kotlin from those classes which were available in jar file. Now this is the interop which is available with Objective-C. So dispatch underscore async is actually an iOS Objective-C API, which now you're importing into the Kotlin file. And this just reroutes this whole call to Grand Central Dispatch of iOS, which reroutes it asynchronously. So now we have an actual variable at iOS level also, and we created a dispatcher for iOS. Now what we did is we did a simple network call, except for threading or background work, whatever you want to call it. We moved everything to Kotlin Common Code. Our whole feature set, our whole methods of HTTP were present in a single file. And then we just created an abstraction on top of dispatcher, which allowed us to reroute this network call to a separate thread. Storage. So again, all application needs storage for offline usage, state management, or whatnot. So SQLite is present both in Android and iOS. I'm pretty sure everyone who has developed any Android or iOS has used it. Again, SQLite is something, it's an extension of SQL meant for mobile devices, but it's not platform specific. The implementations which are present at Android platform and iOS platforms are definitely different, but the whole concept of SQL does not change across platforms. So if you look at SQLite, you have queries and transactions, right? You have a DB, you have query, your transaction, you have got data objects. These things, again, are not platform specific, similarly to what we were able to see with the HTTP call. Serialization and threading, again, the similar concept here. We're going to use a library called SQLDelight. So SQLDelight is a library developed by Square. They build awesome libraries for Android. So they have built awesome library called SQLDelight. What SQLDelight does is you write SQL queries and it generates Kotlin APIs out of it. Now these APIs are they are not dependent on platform. They are like pure Kotlin and they can run on anywhere through Kotlin compilers. So you write queries like this. You create a table. These are like simple SQL queries. You insert into table, and then you get anything from the table. Now, when you create an SQL file, SQLDelight has a Gradle plugin through which it can generate all the APIs. So the moment you create an SQL file and create everything, you can get something called a database. Now you have a complete wrapper on top of your all SQL things, a database. But again, implementation of SQLite is different on Android. Implementation of SQLite is different on iOS. So how do we get that? The driver which is passed here is the connection to the SQLite of each platform. So you initialize driver differently. You initialize an Android SQLite driver, you initialize an iOS SQLite driver. That is the only platform abstraction which exists for this storage solution. So the moment we get the database as a concrete thing, we start doing queries on top of it. Now these are the same queries which we wrote in the SQ files. So you can insert something, you can get something. So your serialization is internally handled by the library, and then threading can be handled using the same concept of dispatches which we did for HTTP call. So again, with storage also, we are at the same stage. The queries and transactions don't really care about platforms, and the database connection is again abstracted using expect and actual variables.
Let's talk about architecture. What architecture should we choose while building a multi-platform application? So how many of you are using any kind of architecture while building an app? Do you guys use? Okay, so any, how many of you are in Android? What about iOS? Okay, cool. So anyone using MVP? MVVM? MVI? Okay, cool. So the truth is you can use any architecture of your choice. It doesn't matter. As long as your business logic is not tied to your UI and you can unit test your business logic separately, where you can use any architecture of your choice. For this example, we are going to use a model view presenter, but any MVStar architecture will work fine. We will share our repository, presenters, and storage network across the platform, and we won't be sharing our activity view controllers, any UI related stuff. So let's see how our code structure looks like. The app folder is our Android app. The common folder is where we write all our business logic in Kotlin. And there's an iOS app at the bottom. And both Android and iOS app consumes this common folder as their dependency. Let's go inside our common folder. Yeah, there are three subdirectories: Android main, common main, and iOS main. Android main is somewhere, common main is somewhere we write all our platform independent Kotlin. Android main and iOS main is kind of similar, where we provide our actual implementation of any expected values. Let's see iOS main. So as you seen in our storage and network explanation, that there was something called expected and actual, right? So you have to provide some actual implementation of some expected values. We are doing exactly that. In dispatcher provider, we are providing iOS specific coroutine dispatcher to do our asynchronous calls. You can ignore this iOS injector for now. This is just a helper class we are using to create an instance of our presenter. iOS driver provider provides the driver connection of our iOS to our SQL Delight. And utils has some log function. And this is our common main. As you can see, all of our business logic is here. In API, we have some classes related to network calls where we get our newses from. Inside data, we have some data classes to hold our app state. Model consists of some repositories. Our repository talks to our network layer and storage layer. Inside presenter, we have all our presenters, and we will look at one of our presenter in the next slide. Inside provider, we are declaring our expected variables. A storage is for a SQL Delight, and utils have some helper functions. Let's look at one of our presenter. Is this visible? Okay. So our main presenter takes two interfaces. One main view interface, which is for communicating back to our activity or view controller in the case of iOS. And data repository is to communicate with our model layer. As soon as user launches the app, this load data function will be called. Inside load data, we are hiding the loader and asking data repository to get our top headlines. And once we get the data, we are displaying the data in a list view and hiding the loader. If someone presses the bookmark icon, we are calling the store article function, where we are asking our data repository to save our article to our database. this is our main view, nothing fancy, just four functions. It's for just to manipulate our UI from our presenter. And this is our main activity. As you can see, our main activity implements our main view and overrides all four functions. Inside display headlines, we are just updating our recycler view adapter using a diff util. Inside show loader and hide loader, we are just toggling the visibility of our progress bar. And inside show error, we are just showing a snack bar or a toast message. And after that, we are injecting our presenter to our activity. And don't get confused, this inject with dagger inject. We are not using any third-party dependency injection tool. It's just a reified function, and it takes our type of our presenter and gives us an instance. As I said before, in onCreate, we are calling the main presenter.onload function. Good thing with multi-platform is that now your iOS view controller looks exactly similar to our activity. It also implements our main view and overrides all four functions. After that, we are injecting our presenter, and on view did load, we are calling presenter.load data. On view load, sorry, view did load is kind of similar to our activity on create method. Now you can see we have shared all of our business logic through the platform, right? The only platform specific code is our activity view controller and all the UI related stuffs. There are all, more great stuff about Kotlin multi-platforms, and Jitin is gonna talk about that.
So let's see what we were able to achieve, right? So mobile platforms have a tendency to, you know, come together. Like we just saw how we have on start, on stop, view did load, view did not load. So especially with Android, iOS, because mobile is mobile, like whether it's Android or iOS, right? And what you can achieve in multi-platform is a better synchronization within your team, because like generally what happens as team grows larger, there is a tendency to do this thing like Android and iOS team like completely branch out. They have no idea what they're doing. They are generally fighting with each other that, you know, this is wrong, this is wrong. So this is true, you all know it. And what multi-platform allows you to do is have a better synchronization between these teams, because now you have a single layer which both of these teams could share. You could include web also if you require, but yeah, web has a bit different API set. And also it allows you to write APIs in such a way, for example, let's say you guys are building a SDK. So you could build a top level API layer in Kotlin itself, which defines how your APIs are going to look like around Android and iOS, and then push them to platforms. Now, how platform implement them, it's up to them. But your Android and iOS SDK end up looking similar because they were built from a single API set, which was written in Kotlin. So these are the things which you can achieve and, you know, bring your teams closer. So they have idea of what is going on in Android, iOS team has idea of what is going in Android, and Android team has idea of what is going in iOS. If I look at advantages, so the biggest advantage of Kotlin multi-platform is Kotlin itself. So Kotlin is a very nice language, great support. It's really popular in Android, and it's getting greater acceptance in other platform also, whether it's server or native. And you can write a lot of expressive code. You could do a lot of things with Kotlin, which were not earlier possible. No custom runtime. So this is one of the, you know, different points with multi-platform, that it does not depend on some sort of runtime. It's like it's gonna compile directly to your platform runtime. So you completely remove a layer of that dependency, that you're not gonna depend on some custom runtime which you're gonna maintain. So it's up to the platform. So it doesn't matter how platform changes tomorrow, it is still gonna run. If it runs today, it's gonna run 10 years later also. Platform specific libraries. So when you start importing Kotlin, so when Android project started importing Kotlin, there was nothing like we have to go from ground zero. It was like I'm already at number 10, and from 11 I'm gonna go start with Kotlin. So that is one of the major advantages of Kotlin, that there is interoperability with everything. So you don't start from ground zero. You are where you are, and you start from there. Whether it's native, whether it's Android, or whether it's JS, you could just start today, and it doesn't matter what your earlier code base was. So some disadvantages, for more code sharing, you depend on multi-platform libraries. For example, in the network call example which we showed, we were using KTOR. Now, if I talk to Android folks, Retrofit is the most popular library here. So you cannot use Retrofit and be multi-platform on top of it. You could still build wrappers on top of Retrofit and, you know, libraries in iOS, like LMFire or something, which they are using. But yeah, if you need more code sharing, you depend on multi-platform libraries. It's still experimental in nature. Kotlin native itself is in beta, and there are, you know, things to figure out around threading. So with multi-platform, yeah, APIs may break, but it's a great thing right now. These are some documentations and libraries. First is the Kotlin's multi-platform documentation, coroutines library, squares library, SQL Delight, serialization, and ktor. And the last is the code sample which we showed in this presentation. Also, Square has recently announced that they're going to build a lot of multi-platform libraries. If you have worked with OKHttp, OKHttp will soon become multi-platform. They have already started work on that. So the future is great. A lot of companies are depending on it. So let's see how it pans out. Thank you for your patience and listening to this stuff. And if you have any questions. Yeah, we'll share the link. We'll upload it on SpeakerTech and share the link.
Maybe Google slide, Google Photos.
Presentation or code?
Code is already there.
Yeah, code is already there. How to create? IPA. So your Xcode project is not, your Xcode project is not going anywhere. It's there. So if you're thinking that no, there is no Xcode project, it's there. You just import a lot of stuff in Xcode, and then your IPA is there. There is nothing going away. You have your Android project and
Android.
Your iOS project still resides in Xcode. That is not going anywhere.
Multi-platform thing is just a framework file for you. That's all. You are just importing a framework and all that.
So, framework means it doesn't have the front end is there.
Did you mean front end? Did you mean UI by friend? No, UI is on iOS only. We are writing our UI in Swift only. We are just sharing our business logic, not the UI part.
Business logic is important.
Right.
So let me add, if you want to write view controllers in Kotlin, that is also possible. Yeah. So the point is, if you start writing everything in Kotlin, what will happen to your iOS developers, right? That is the question. And iOS developers like Swift, and I cannot argue with them that Swift is bad. Swift is a good language. So the point is, how can we come to a common ground with Android and iOS developers? So business logic is the common ground of all applications. With UI, I would say it's a personal choice. You want to write UI in Swift, you write UI in Swift. But UI is something which cannot be shared, right? Because life cycles differ. So, but the business logic you can easily share. So you do that in Kotlin, and that imported both places.
Yes, you can.
Web also, you can write everything in Kotlin. Yes, sir.
How experimental is this? Can I use this in production?
You can use it in production, but please don't do it right now, because the whole multi-platform thing is in experimental phase only.
A few people have done it, so it's not like it's going to completely break. So I met a developer. There's an app called Quizlet. It's quite popular in US. They have like put multi-platform in production, and it's like millions of users are using it. So definitely, if you want to try out and you feel it's stable for your project, you can definitely put it into production. A lot of people are not doing it, but a few of people have done it. So I would suggest, if anyone is interested in this, Kotlin Conf, which is going to happen later this year, is going to come up with a lot of case studies where people have put Kotlin multi-platform in production. So you can get a list of all the companies who have done that. Can you give mic? One second, we cannot hear you. Sorry.
Is that efficient that we write our business logic into web services like Spring Boot and Node.js for production?
Oh, you're saying Spring Boot with
Spring
Kotlin?
Spring Boot, or REST services like SOAP, REST, web
so
services.
Saying Spring Boot with Kotlin?
Spring Boot, I like to put my Spring Boot in backend, like using retrofit, all those libraries, and frontend in Kotlin. So is that efficient?
What
Spring Boot is efficient. Like if we want to use microservices in our app, like for multi-platform, like iOS and Android. So is that efficient?
You want to write Spring Boot in Kotlin?
No, server in Kotlin. So
you're saying your Spring Boot server is in Kotlin and it has microservices in it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it doesn't matter. You can have anything. It's like building a general application. So multi-platform does not change the status quo. You still build application how you used to. If that works for you, it will work here also.
Thank you.
We'll take questions outside. We are just here. So if anyone has any other doubt. Thank you again.
Thank you.